Aloha and welcome to Island Connections. I am Ibrahim Aoude, your host for this program. And the program is Labor at a Crossroads. And with us we have three longtime labor activists who will be discussing the issue of labor with us. Quon, McElrath, thank you for coming. She's a longtime labor activist and also recently retired from the Board of Regents of the University of Hawai'i. And Raymond Camacho, he's with the ILWU, and he's Division Director for Oahu. Thank you for coming. And Eric Gill, Local 5, Secretary, Financial Secretary, Treasurer of Local 5. Thanks for coming. So would you like to say something opening the show about the state of labor in Hawaii, AQ?
Well, if you were to talk about the state of labor in Hawaii, you'd have to take a look at the national and international situation. I see several factors that affect labor at the crossroads. One is the nature of organizing and what impinges on it. Changes in demography, technology. Two, the protection of what labor now has in the books. And that is to say, what is happening with the National Labor Relations Act? Is labor, in fact, going to mount a campaign for the repeal of Taft-Hartley? The other is, how can we protect labor's gains thus far? The 13.5% of the American workforce that is now in trade unions, and that would mean changes in ERISA, which affect the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation and what workers get in retirement, whether they should allow themselves to be pushed into defined benefit programs, pushed rather into defined contribution programs as against defined benefit programs. What are the possibilities, for example, of taking health care off the bargaining table in order to truly work on the right to health care through a single-payer universal health plan so that you avoid fighting at the collective bargaining table over increased premiums, increased co-payments, increased deductibles, contracting benefits, as well as onslaughts on the eligibility for health care? And I think also what labor at the crossroads needs to do is to take a look at the nature of the political economy and to assess whether or not the redistribution of income is taking place in an equitable, in a just manner, especially in light of the huge tax cuts of the Bush administration. More or less, I think that begins to indicate where we are at the crossroads.
Yeah. Thanks. And also, like, there has been a wind of change in labor of late, and there have been challenges to, you know, the traditional labor leaders and so on. And, you know, Eric, you're one of the people who challenged the labor leaders in your local five. And also, we have Ray Camacho. You're Oahu Division Director at ILWU, but you're running also for President of ILWU. So would you like to tell us something about why you are doing that and what you see ahead for labor?
Well, I think we're running for president. You know, our president has been a great leader for the ILWU, Eusebio Bolapena, and he's retiring. And I think what Quon touched upon is our union has been confronting that on all different levels, from on the rank and file level, where the workers and their families are feeling exactly what the global economy is imposing upon us, and which is the distribution of wealth. I think Quon captured that quite you know, nicely, that when we bargain collectively across the table, what we're facing is a shifting of some of the more fundamental benefits that our workers have enjoyed over the years that we, you know, as working people have taken for granted. Now, it's a dogfight just to maintain what we have. And it does start, I think, with the current administration President Bush and this administration has a clear anti-union agenda. And I believe the governor of the state, Linda Lingle, a Republican, has her own way of interpreting that agenda, but the net result is the same. I think it's a rollback, an attack on working people. And as far as my role in all of this, I believe I represent, I guess, a new generation of leaders. And I believe that labor, we need to link arm in arm and face these challenges ahead, and that's what I want to do if I'm elected president.
Sure. Well, great. And Eric, you've been in this position for, 3 years now or so? So any developments that you can talk about in terms of changing the face of at least Local 5?
Well, I think the key to changing the face of Local 5 or any other union is to recognize where the source of the power of the union comes from, and to be able to direct and wield resources of the union to build on that power. And, you know, in its final sense, and when you get right down to it, the power of the union comes from the membership united, the members being united together to act as one and to utilize their numbers both, you know, on the street and in the ballot box and so on. The labor movement has had a period in Hawaii of a fairly extended peacetime, if you will, where the political interests in Hawaii didn't really come four square and challenge us head on. And I think many of our unions got a little bit complacent and haven't really organized themselves well enough to withstand this. You know, here we have Bush, you know, making all-out attacks on labor, which has been pointed out, and that's certainly true. And yet many of our members are still entranced maybe in whatever propaganda or, you know, the macho posturing of Bush, which appeals to maybe the baser instincts in American people. And, you know, we need to be able to educate our members, we need to be able to organize them, and we need to be able to produce their bodies at the voting booth to vote. And that requires organization and communication, and it requires us, and it has required us in Local 5 to redirect resources to do that. You know, whereas in the past maybe staff was used in a different fashion. That builds our power, both in contract negotiations, which certainly every member understands, and we need to be able to extend that out into the political field as well and make people realize, as they once did, that working people have a common interest and that we're all in this together and that we should vote for candidates and so on that represent our interests. So as far as what's going on in Local 5, we continue to have challenges. We've had, you know, last year we had a big crisis trying to set a standard for the hotel industry, and we were successful in setting a pretty good standard. And we've been basically trying to wrap the rest of the hotels into it. We, you know, just last week, Friday, we were able to settle with the Kahala Mandarin on the basis of the standard. And I think as a hopeful sign, as Ray said, we all have to join hands. Our union and ILWU have for many years been at odds for a variety of reasons, but there's some hopeful signs there. And, you know, Ray and I were able to cooperate and negotiate a good contract for two hotels, one represented by either union, which are owned by the same owner. So I think we have some models to build on. But ultimately, you know, I would love to be able to talk about a union campaign to you know, redraft or repeal Taft Hartley.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I think at this point we're trying to hold on to what we got, as Ray said, and I think the solution to both is the same. You know, get reorganized, focus on the membership, get real about making members involved, and build that power base, and that will help defend us as well as set the stage for us to move forward as well.
Good. Yeah, we have a segment on tape that I interviewed John Wittick, so when it's ready we can roll it and then we can comment on that. Mm-hmm.
Labor has had a down period. Of course, all the whole economy in Hawaii has suffered from a recession. But the unions, I think, in general, have suffered from a lack of imagination, a lack of vision, and a lack of leadership. The State Federation of Labor, of course, had Gary Rodriguez as president for a while, and Rodriguez is the UPW leader who recently was indicted, has been removed from that union. But under his stewardship, the AFL-CIO did not do much. It got better recently with some input from the ILWU. And I think labor in general has benefited from the new militancy and imaginative tactics and strategy of the Local 5 HERE. The hotel and restaurant workers have given a new boost and a new oomph to the labor movement. The public sector, it has been weakened, I think, by the indictment and conviction of Rodriguez. The HGA, the largest union that I am in, tended to follow the UPW. And the UPW, unfortunately, towards the end, did not believe in mobilizing membership. It was pretty much a one-man dictatorship. And so whatever Rodriguez could work out a deal with legislators or other people or Cayetano, that's pretty much what the workers got. And unions like HGA tended to follow. Now I think HGA has to find its own direction and is beginning to do that. The HSTA in the last 5 years has been incredible. They mobilized, they had a fairly effective strike, along with UPA. And they did a very good job of mobilizing public relations, public support, and UPA too. UPA was able to rally public sympathy and support from people on campus and people off campus. But those were two, I think, good examples of educators and teachers going out and winning support. And HSTA was very good. I think it showed democratic unions in which members are recruited and mobilized and involved and informed, those unions are stronger.
Yeah, so here's another overview of the state of labor with the specific unions in mind. So any comments on this, AQ?
Well, I was fascinated by Mr. Wittig's assessment of the strength of HSTA and UPA. I happen to have been on the Board of Regents when their contracts came up for negotiations. But I think that we now face a much larger problem in public education, which has been brought on by the federal legislation, Leave No Child Behind. Under that bit of legislation, can you imagine 85% of the public schools of our nation are said to be deficient? And yet, although they said that they were going to appropriate something like $257 billion for Leave No Child Behind, actually only $44 billion has been allotted to carry out the provisions of that law. At the local level, when you tie in the fact that we are having our problems with No Child Left Behind, and the fact that the Lingle administration has appointed a blue ribbon panel to look into the whole situation of public education, brings up in my mind, something is going to happen with what, despite all of its shortcomings, the fact that Hawaii has a single school board with monies that are allocated justly to all of the school districts, to every child in the state of Hawaii, and which incidentally is the envy of many other states which depend, separate school boards depending upon collections in real property tax in a very narrow frame, so to speak, in order to educate the children. I think that one of the big jobs of the labor movement in the next few months is to take a very close look at what that particular committee is going to do and work very closely with HSTA as well as UPA on how this particular committee is going to work out public education. After all, most of the children of union members go to public schools. And there is absolutely no way in which we should allow them to monkey around with the basic justice of how public schools are now financed by the state of Hawaii. Any other way would leave it, for example, subject to all of the county tax powers, which are very little in effect. And so to me, that is a challenge so far as the public workers cooperating with workers in the private sector is concerned.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let me go to another segment that speaks about the ILWU, and then we can talk about this issue plus the one on the ILWU. So when the tape is ready.
Take it away, Ray.
Well, it would appear as though something's gone wrong with your segment. Yeah. Maybe what we ought to do is say, what can we do with regard to our being watchdogs on the Committee on Labor?
Yeah. So, Ray, do you want to say something on that?
Well, maybe just quickly, just comments on John Wittig. I think what comes to mind in some of the things that he had mentioned was political action, and how over the last several years, each union, private sector, public sector, there's been some cutting edge issues that have confronted that union. I think Eric with HERE, they've had tremendous gains in their negotiating of the hotel agreements, as he said, and we had the pleasure to work together, because I think we see the same thing, that with the nature of tourism being what it is and the critical role it plays in the economy, we need to be a strong advocate in good times and bad for, you know, the members we represent. And there's certain key issues, job security and subcontracting and healthcare and retirement, that whether they're an ILWU worker, a HERE member, or a non-union employee in a hotel industry, standards need to be upheld and uplifted by the labor movement. And through political action, the only thing I wanted to mention is I was very disappointed with the Democratic Party, which is probably not a surprise at this body here, in the failure to act on the worker retention bill, as an example. That bill, with a Democratic majority, should have passed, simply stated, to allow workers who are displaced through no fault of their own to be allowed a chance to retain their jobs. And, you know, I'm very disappointed, but, you know, we're not defeated, because we believe, and, you know, hopefully Eric will be at my side, we're going to push that bill through. And the way we're going to do it is getting every member of every union, private sector or public sector, to support something that will help everybody. And that's just a comment on that.
Yeah, we have a tape that speaks to the ILWU issue. Interviewed Dean Allegado on that. Oh. So we take a look at that, and then we can discuss things further.
The membership has been changing from agriculture to now the overwhelming majority, I would say probably two-thirds or more, are either in hotel and restaurants or general trades, which is very interesting because these are also generally in comparison to sugar, pine, and longshore, also are less stable. And although because of the plantations, they've run away, but more in terms of leadership, I believe. So there's an interesting election coming up there, where I believe you'll be interviewing Ray Camacho, who's the head or the director of the ILWU for Oahu. He's running for election against, probably they'll describe as someone in the old guard, and it should be a close one. And Ray Camacho's running mate is a woman from Maui representing the hotel and restaurant and other service workers there. So it's interesting, and I believe in a way in other unions like HSTA also went through a leadership change Hotel and Restaurant Workers Union, Local 5, went through that. So there are a new generation of leaders, I think. People who were in their 20s and 30s and were considered young Turks are now in their 40s and 50s and accumulated a lot of practical experiences in their respective unions.
Yeah, so here's Dean on the ILWU. Any quick comments on that before we open it up to talk about
that? He sounds almost like my campaign manager. but Dean's a good friend of mine, and I think he has good insights into the ILWU. He studied it academically for many years and has a pretty good feel and a passion for it because a lot of the kids that he teaches here at the university are plantation kids or ILWU children who've gotten scholarships and whatnot to attend the university. But I think I would characterize his comments as being fairly accurate. There is a change in the leadership. Bola Pena retiring, he's probably the third in a line of presidents who hail out of sugar, the sugar industry, which is shrinking, you know, as a result of the world economy. I come out of the hotel industry. And when people ask me that, hotel worker, yes, that's true, but on Oahu, we have one hotel, another we're trying to negotiate a contract for, and I've negotiated almost everything but hotels. But I've had a lot of experience with hotels as well. And my philosophy is really, I want to get back to the basics, get back to the generation that gave us what we have. Aquan's generation is really what built the labor movement and made us have what we have today. And we need to get back to those basics, simple as that.
But the irony about this whole thing to which you referred, and certainly to which Dean referred, is that the change in the political economy, which has put us in the whole tourism industry, especially because of statehood and the coming of the jets, that particular industry is one over which we have very little control, simply because the rest of the political economy in the rest of the world dictates whether or not people have enough money to travel to Hawaii. All you need do is take a look at the depression, that recession they called it, that we went through in the just before 1991. All you need do is take a look at what happened after 9/11. All you need do is take a look at what's happening to the Japanese economy, and you will say, what kind of control do we have over tourism? All you need do is read the minutes and read the newspaper articles of our tourism authority. There is absolutely nothing that can be done. And as long as WTO, NAFTA, IMF, World Bank continue to do the kinds of development that they do in other countries, you will not have the rank and filers being able to get on an airplane and vacation here in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. In other words, there is an uneven capitalist development which does not give the same kinds of gains to people out there as against people here. It's all up there that gets all of the money. So, look, you're going to face, you, Eric, and you, Camacho, are going to be facing this problem from now until doomsday.
So what have you got to say to that? That's true.
I knew somewhere in this program IQ would start pointing at me.
I love to talk to AQ because she always scolds me.
Yeah.
Look, I think there's certainly some truth in that the flow of tourist dollars, if you will, is due to many things that are beyond the control of any local economic engine. But I also think that we have to look at the reality of collective bargaining, how it works. The truth is that when you're able to unionize and have represented the majority of the industry, you can get far better contracts. And the best example of that is the differential, say, between Hawaii and New York. where New York is over 90% of the hotels represented by Local 6. And the housekeepers in New York by 2006 will be making $20 an hour with a full benefit package. And by no means do I think that that is sufficient in itself in terms of redistributing the wealth, because the company obviously still makes considerable profits that would probably be better put in workers' pockets. But for us here in Hawaii, the real question is, how do we achieve that kind of density, and what kind of control can we put on tourism? And I think it is possible to do that, and many other communities have done that. For example, in Boston, New York, San Francisco, they have a municipal laws that require that if public money is being, or public support is being given to a hotel development, that that hotel developer needs to agree to recognize the union if the majority of the workers sign up with the union. We've never done that here. In fact, we've been giving away massive tax breaks and tax credits and zoning breaks worth millions and millions of dollars to hotel corporations without even asking anything in return as a community. You know, the best example recently is a $75 million given to Ko'olina, which has no commitments whatsoever and no union contracts whatsoever in any of those places out there, and which do not meet the union standard for wages and benefits. So what we have here is we have an opportunity, I think, with this coming session to demonstrate that. It's about time this community said, look, if we're going to give you any, you know, if you're going to give you our beaches and all the other things that go into it, you know, trash collection and water and roads and police protection and fire protection and all the other things we pay for, where's the guarantee that we get good jobs in return? Not just any job, not just another job. You have to have three jobs to make a living, or I think in the recent movie, what did they say, work three jobs just so you can earn enough to be broke? I mean, that's the reality of work here in Hawaii, and the fact is we do have to get more money out of them. The other piece is that these hotel corporations are huge. They are huge, and in the last 10 years, they have grown exponentially. Hyatt, Marriott, Hilton, Starwood. Starwood was nothing 10 years ago. Wasn't even on the screen, and now it's a huge company with, you know, hundreds of hotels. And to deal with a company like that, you need to have a real credible economic threat. And what we've found in our union, we are a nationwide hotel union, we found that no one city can stand alone. We asked for and received a lot of help last year during our contract fight with the Hilton and the Starwood from our sister locals across the country. And we're asking more now. I've got three locals leafleting this week, you know, in support of our negotiations at Turtle Bay. We found that it's not enough anymore to have a strong local union in the hotel industry. We need to have strong local union by, you know, in all the cities, and good cooperation. And I think in Hawaii, ultimately, the way to extend this, there is no, you know, regardless of the difficulty, and I'm sure there's a lot of difficulty in both unions, but for ILWU and for Local 5, for us to achieve what we could achieve, we're going to have to work together. We're going to have to bargain together. We're going to have to organize together. We're going to have to legislate together. I think we can. It's not going to be easy, but it's something we have to do.
Yeah. In other words, yeah, what he is suggesting is that we take a leaf out of the merger psychology of all of the employers throughout the United States. One of the other interesting things, it seems to me, as we begin to think of how we can spread the wealth around, is to see if using the concept of a living wage might be one way in which we can standardize, let's say, the wages for all hotel workers, plus you can ask for an added percentage on those hotels which make X numbers of dollars beyond the profit margin. So in other words, what I'm saying is that while there are standards to collective bargaining, we need to alter the way we take a look at how we make gains for our workers, simply because the world is moving so rapidly. The nature of the economy is changing so rapidly, and we've got to be able to keep in step with all of the changes that are taking place. You're bargaining with ILWU and asking for help of locals on the mainland with the same employers is a step in the right direction. Yeah. What you're doing is taking a leaf from the employer's notebook as to how to screw workers. Now you can, you'll learn how to screw them.
Let's go and see what's happening with the public unions, because here we're talking about private unions. And I have interviewed Dina Legado again. He talks about UPA and the economy here.
UPA, I think, is taking a hard look at how we're going to approach this upcoming period, because all the state, city, and county, the public workers' unions were all coming up for negotiations, and the recent contract talks between the bus drivers and the police unions, where they were able to make gains. Of course, there were public relation code missteps, especially on the part of the Teamsters. But I think members are probably, you know, much more willing to struggle for a better deal and not buy the line that, you know, the state has no revenues and, you know, it's cutting back services. And here we are, the university faculty making some unreasonable demands, which is the standard public relations line that the state has been putting out, including the city and county. So we'll have to look at how the economy is going. You know, as you know, the military is putting in a lot of money, this $1 billion construction contract, the proposal to base an aircraft carrier over here, a Stryker division, all of that. So that part of the economy, and then apparently tourism seems to be more stable, so they expect the revenue for the state, especially since recently the real estate market brought in a lot more taxes. So from the broader economic situation, the unions, all the unions, I believe, including UHPA, will be taking a stronger stand on the economic issues.
Yeah, and also there's another interview I did with Robert Perkinson, also about UPA and Lingle. So we can later on talk about it and talk about what Dean has just said. So
UPA finds itself in the awkward position of having endorsed the Republican governor, move unusual for a union to endorse a Republican governor. And UPA's now sort of hoping that endorsing the governor means she's going to have all sorts of goodwill for us, and she's promised to do so, to increase the percentage of the state government that goes to the state budget, that goes to the university, and so on. But so far, she hasn't done any of that, and hasn't really done much for us at all, other than allowing UPA to sort of indirectly name one member of the Board of Regents, a former UPA president. So UPA faces the question now of, do we continue being nice to the governor and supporting the governor and hoping she comes around to our side and gives us a better deal than maybe some of the other unions will get on their own? Or do we start moving toward a more antagonistic stance and holding her accountable to the promises she made in a more aggressive way, like we did with Ben Caetano? Personally, the direction I'm advocating is I think UPA needs to become much more aggressive about holding the state and the governor accountable and saying, look, if we really want economic diversification in Hawaii, if we really want economic development, if we really want to move away from the sort of plantation tourism dependency model, colonial model of the economy that has existed in Hawaii for 100 years or more, then that's going to take pouring real resources into primary, secondary education and higher education. And that the legislature and the governor have not done. They haven't really made any moves toward. And where Governor Lingle has put her capital so far is behind, you know, she wants to build a new prison or two, a treatment prison to deal with the ICE problem. She has not a tax, and the Democrats have stayed strong behind their tax giveaways to supposedly high-tech companies, but most of it ends up going to Hollywood movies like Blue Crush and so on. The governor has stayed strong behind giving money to hotels to pay for their remodeling or giving money to the Ko'olina resort and so on. So far, yet again, the state has put its fiscal priorities behind the tourism industry and behind business and behind tax cuts for people who are already doing the best, this sort of neo-supply side style of economic management. And UPA and the other public sector unions are really going to have to try to change that, or we're just going to be fighting and scrapping over a smaller and smaller pie.
Yeah, well, actually, I'm interested in finding out what private sector unions have to say about what Robert and Dean were saying. Ray, would you want to take a shot at it?
Well, I think from the ILWU standpoint, I can't speak for all of private sector, yeah. But I think with UPA's endorsement of the governor, from our standpoint, it was misplaced. I think both speakers' comments alluded to the fact that the governor was making an appeal, a political appeal to a segment of the labor, and it worked. Mm-hmm. That there was certain promises made for higher education, an emphasis, and redirection of resources and whatnot. And you know, again, typical Republican style. I think Lingo has proven that she is a Republican after all. You know, once the dust is settled, she's killing the West Oahu campus. She's Quon had spoken earlier about her move to decentralize the Board of Education, which for my union in particular, the overwhelming bulk of our membership and our children go to public schools on the neighbor islands, and that would be devastating for the children of the ILWU union. Mm-hmm. So I think, hopefully, and we want to work with the public sector unions. I think we all have to come to the realization that, yes, Governor Lingo is a Republican after all, and the Republican agenda is to bolster the increase in profits for business on the backs of workers, whether it's a blue-collar worker who's working in a construction site or a hotel worker cleaning tables in a restaurant, or whether it's a longshoreman on the docks, or whether it's a professor at the university. We're all helping bring wealth to the state, and we're all trying to increase the standard of living for the people here. But if the head of the government in Hawaii is only catering to a certain segment of society, there's something wrong with that picture. And I think that's where the unions, and this union in particular, we want to reach out to private sector and public sector unions to, you know, make a big push in 2006, and we need a change.
Yes. Yeah. You have similar ideas on?
Yeah, I think, first of all, I understand completely why UPA members might have voted for a Lingo candidacy. They were certainly had good reason to be disenchanted with the Democratic administration that had just forced them out on a very difficult strike. I think it kind of illustrates one of the frustrations many of us have with the political structure of our society, where basically you get to choose between Democrat and Republican, and you better hope that you like one of them. Otherwise, you vote for somebody you don't like, but not as much as the other. In this case, certainly Lingo has... here's UPA's already been a target, and so far with some success, of the Right to Work Foundation, which is, of course, a political base of the Republicans, and Right to Work legislation will be, and I believe already has been, introduced into the legislature by Republicans. And that's an assault on all unions. So I think it's good that public sector unions are reevaluating this, because in the private sector it's been painful watching
the continued assault on the public sector without a coherent and a cohesive mass response. I would love to see the public workers really get their organization together and get their votes together, because of course, you know, you're talking about the two of the top three, you know, numerical membership unions in Hawaii, and very important unions from the standpoint of the politics of Hawaii and the politics of the labor movement. I'm very hopeful that UPW will find its way out. It's certainly had a rough road in recent years, and they're embarking on a new set of leadership. I think that I'm very hopeful. I don't know how to call it. I'm not familiar enough with how it goes on in there. HGEA certainly is I think they understand the problem. I think they're taking some efforts to deal with that. But from this private sector point of view, you know, we don't want to just stand by and say, oh, gee, okay, I'm glad they're fighting them. Yeah. You know, we want to support the public workers, and we should, and we will.
Yeah, you mentioned the UPW. So I interviewed John Wittick, which he talked about the change in the UPW, and then we come back and discuss that.
There was another good wind of change. There was a rank-and-file movement who petitioned, who forced the International to come in, who forced the International to get Rodriguez out and put a temporary trustee in. And currently there are elections going on. And for the first time in a long time, UPW has slates of candidates that are not dictated by leadership, in which rank and file people are going out and putting forth ideas, programs, and running as a slate for change. So they're having those elections now in December. They'll elect new statewide leadership. And so that's a healthy sign. Whether the changes will be adequate, whether they can address all the problems of getting decent pay benefits, job security for public workers, or making alliances with private sector workers is still to be seen. But many of the people running have those kinds of ideas.
Yeah, well, we've been talking about what needs to be done and so on. So I interviewed also Robert Perkinson, and he talks about that issue, and then we can discuss.
Actually, a majority of the leadership in UPA here in Hawaii would like to see the National Education Association, which is the umbrella union for UPA, join with the American Federation of Teachers, which would then form the largest union in the U.S. and would be part of the AFL-CIO, so could join with other working families fighting for a more democratic and just economy than the really aristocratic model of economic management that the Bush administration has been pursuing, which is, you know, the solution to every social problem is to give wheelbarrows full of cash to wealthy folks. So I would like to see us do that. So far, that hasn't been able to happen. In that case, we'd be able to join the AFL-CIO locally. Although UPA has been trying to reach out to other unions, making ties to the Hawaii Teachers Association. You know, we ended up walking with the nurses a lot when they were on strike, and have been pretty involved in various labor discussions to the extent that we can be outside of the AFL-CIO. There is also in the Hawaii labor movement, one of the bright spots that I see is the changes that are taking place in HERE, the Hotel Employee Restaurant Employee Workers Union, Local 5 here under the leadership of Eric Gill. And they whereas most of the unions in Hawaii, and I think UPA to a certain extent is guilty of this as well, have allowed their membership to be rather complacent. The notion is the membership, they pay their dues, they vote occasionally, they leave it up to the board, and really mostly to staff, their executive directors and so on, to manage the affairs of the union, to advocate for them, to pursue legal or political strategies that are appropriate in order to get them better pay. The problem with that model is, as I see it, if everybody agrees, it's fine, but if the employer really goes after working people, the only power unions really have to draw upon is our base. Is the fact that we can mobilize voters, we can put people in the streets, we can put people in legislators' offices, we can have people lobbying for different legislators. We have people power behind us because we don't have as much money as the university will have or private corporations will have for lobbying or slick media campaigns or political donations. We're never going to be able to compete economically.
Yeah, like Robert connected things together, and the macro view that you were looking at in the beginning, AQ, you know, he's talking about similar stuff. So would you like to comment?
Yeah, I think what Robert has, what Robert said, raises a number of very basic issues. One goes to political action. At which point will the labor movement recognize and realize that you can't have 25 different slates and have your membership understand why A is better than B when this union thinks C is better? Why is it not possible then for all of the unions to get together and say, our program to advance the state, to preserve our gains, to protect our organizing, is this, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items. These are the people whom we are going to endorse in order for us to be sure that our vision of what the world should be is at least in fact met by these 10-15 people whom we endorse. Once we learned that lesson, which was true in the early days of political action of the ILWU, you can have almost anything on a platter handed to you because these people will truly fear that they will not be reelected. And most of them just work to be reelected anyway. And for what reason? The other thing is the incentives that you alluded to and which Robert alluded to. Act 221 was put into effect with absolutely no demands of the employers to return back to the state of Hawaii some of the kinds of things that you are asking about. They got tax credits, but they didn't say we'll take care of the infrastructure. We won't allow we will allow a union to come on in. We will improve the wages of our workers, even without a union, by doing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things. Now, it seems to me that if we are to give incentives, we should learn from what the South did not get when they gave free land, tax incentives, and all of the other kinds of things to automobile manufacturers, and we had to fight like hell in order to get a union recognized. Yeah. One of the other kinds of things that are very important that Robert alluded to was, what is there that we are doing about economic development? If agriculture, in terms of sugar and pine, are literally out of the picture, what are we doing about diversified agriculture? What we've diddled around with being Silicon Valley, apparently we're not going to be able to do that. But there are all kinds of things we can do with alternate energy, simply because we're paying so much money for fossil fuels. I know that HNEI, which is attached to the University of Hawaii, which is Natural Energy Resource Development, is working on the problem. What else can the state do in order for us to advance more electricity through solar, through wind, through hydro power, as per the Big Island? All of these kinds of things which can be done, and in which the state can work out partnerships with private industry, all of the electric companies in all of the counties. There are other kinds of things. The environment. What are we doing about that? We say that we are different, therefore people will come to Hawaii, but in effect we are destroying much of our environment. And the whole thing of other energy resources, for example, goes to whether or not we save the environment at the same time. Now, as to the university, if in fact we feel that education is a right for people, just as we think health is a right for people, and therefore we are going to use alternative ways of ensuring health care for all of the people of Hawaii, let alone the United States, then we've got to ask a very basic question. What kinds of dollars go into higher education, and what should the academic program and the practical program consist of? To me, these are very basic to what is a university there for. It's not only to turn out workers, it's also to be sure, we turn out people who can use this wonderful thing called the brain and this thing called the heart and come out with ideas as to how we can advance the university and the people who live in the state.
Right. More on negotiations and how to arrive at those kinds of things that we like. John Wittick on negotiations and strikes. Yeah.
The situation with HST and UPA is shared by HGEA, by UPW. UPW gave up 2 years with no pay hike in the last bargaining. Of course, they were weakened by the turmoil within the union. HGA, I'm on the negotiating committee, they reluctantly took a one-year no pay hike situation, and we're back in negotiation for that old, for the contract for the next 2 or 3 years. I think the problem I've seen, one is the government's tactic under the new law, is if they delay, they force you to a time period, April 15th, April 16th, April 17th. Their tactic has been, here's a last offer, take it or leave it. And if you don't want to go into strike situation or binding arbitration or what, at that time we didn't have binding arbitration. Now we do, the legislature overrode the veto, so HGA won back the right to arbitrate. The unusual thing is unions usually fight for the right to strike, so it was very, very peculiar, weird even, for a union to be insisting and fighting for the right to not to strike. And generally, the positions of the unions is our members don't want to strike. That's always true. People, strikes are hardships, they're sacrifices. Look at the bus drivers. They're not easy. Nobody likes to strike, but unless you have that weapon, you pretty much are begging. And I think the public employee unions have been begging for the last few years. They look to the Lingle administration, but they really, for some change, but the Lingle administration is a continuation of politics of the Cayetano administration.
Eric, would you have been able to accomplish much of recent things that you have gained without strikes or through negotiations?
Well, actually, we haven't had to strike, and we have achieved good contracts without a strike. However, I can tell you that you don't get anything, at the bargaining table, not with these hotels, who basically all of them have, all these huge corporations have whole teams, and they have a system-wide, corporation-wide strategy on concentrating forces against any local union that stands up to them. So, you know, to utilize a strike weapon, you really have to have a very good understanding of the situation and a good analysis. And we've been able to generate that by developing a strong research component and a strong research department, not just here, but across the country, which has allowed us to track the hotel corporations and their policy changes, their weaknesses, their economic vulnerabilities, and so on. But more than that, you really have to have a coordinated negotiation and organizing strategy in terms of organizing committees and building a real communication network and promoting and training rank and file leaders and coordinating all that with your bargaining. You have to design your bargaining position in such a way that that you can get people excited about it, and you have to recruit the leaders in the shop. If you don't, they'll cut you off at your knees. You know, just last week I was ejected from a hotel under threat of arrest, and you know, that for talking to people. I mean, I was told you can come around, but you can't talk to anyone. It's like, what do I do for a living besides talk to people and talk to workers? But in any event, the what happens is if you don't have that, the company can intervene if it's all staff driven. So again, it comes down to organizing the membership. And if you have the membership organized, and if you have the point of pressure properly identified, and if you're able to communicate clearly to the company what the retribution will be in the event of a strike, then it's possible to get good contracts without a strike. I think the opposite is also true. If you stumble into a strike without adequate preparation, without a good analysis, then it can be a very unpleasant experience and set you back considerably. But I think it's possible to do it without a strike, but not unless you're proving to the company that you're capable of winning one. That's the first thing you have to do.
Organizing the unorganized. We have a tape on Robert Perkinson on organizing graduate students. You know, that's one thing. And then we can talk about organizing in the public sector as well.
Graduate students around the country are, as universities have moved more and more of their teaching load toward grad students as federal government support for higher education has been declining with the end of the Cold War. As universities have moved more and more of their teaching to graduate students around the country have responded by forming unions, and it's going on at NYU and Columbia and Yale and all sorts of other places. The grad students here have a much more compelling argument for unionization than some of those others, so that's something UPA has been looking at as well, is maybe trying to organize the graduate students at some point and get a larger section of the university community in dialogue about what's the direction we ought to be going.
Yeah, let's look at another segment by Robert Perkinson that he talks about the macro view, and then we can talk about the place of organizing the unorganized within that macro view, the vision that AQ was talking about.
It's possible that the free market fundamentalism that has been guiding American economic and social policy for the last generation, from the late 70s forward, and especially from the Reagan years forward, you know, the idea that the primary stakeholders that matter in economy are corporations and the very wealthy, and that if you shower them with largesse, then it will all trickle down and everybody else will benefit. And that the solution to any economic crisis is to shovel even more money to those people. It seems like with the successive wars and the absolutely unprecedented and colossal tax cuts that have taken us from the greatest budget surplus in American history to the greatest budget deficit in American history may so devastate the American economy and government that we may finally, just like happened in the 1930s, Americans may finally start to wake up from their Fox News-induced haze and realize that the people who've been running this country for a while have, in their name, have not been doing so in their interest. And if that's the case, it's a real opportunity for leaner, meaner, more organized unions like HERE or UPA or HSTA to really step up and say, we offer an alternative. We offer another way to use our collective pooled resources, taxpayer money, to generate economic growth and to make a better society. And this is how we would like it to look. We want to support not hotel remodeling, but university remodeling. We want to support not building a new prison, but building new schools. And if we can, I think some of that is behind the skyrocketing Howard Dean campaign for president, who was dismissed as a real crackpot at first. But there's a lot of anger and growing anger, and even in Republican circles, doubt about this in very rigidly ideological direction that the Bush administration is taking the country, a less ideological, less extremist position that the Lingle administration is taking, but she's part of this Republican movement that, at least in the kind of global political spectrum, tends toward the fanatical. So she has pursued a lot of these policies as well, although not nearly to the same degree of extremism. But they may be overreaching. And if they overreach and we're ready for them, then we actually could move into an era of, I think, revitalized democracy, more sharing of the wealth. You know, economic inequality in the U.S. has been going up, 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 up. We're back all the way to the robber baron age of the 1920s and before. But that can be reversed. It's just going to take us moving in a different direction. And unions have to play a key role in that.
Yeah, so Ray, your comment on this in terms also of organizing the unorganized.
Well, I think that's really the key solution to everything is you have to organize at the workplace. You got to organize to get economic justice. You have to organize on the job. You have to organize at the ballot box. And I think a lot of it looks very imposing. Looking to the future over the next several years, this is quite a task for the labor movement, but I'm very optimistic, and I'll explain why. Number one, I think the ILWU could play a role with HERE, and I think by working together, you know, Eric alluded to it, organizing jointly, working together on political issues together at the legislature is going to be the key.
Yeah, thank you very much for coming, and thank our viewers for watching, and see you next month, December. Mahalo.